use it on your own Sandbox, on your own computer, in your own development cycle tools. Now, my wife always tells me I'm an introvert, and you can introduce yourself first to people properly. My name is Michał, I am Polish, I'm sorry, those of you who feel offended that I speak English. I've been programming, doing some sort of programming since the 90s. I am old in my book, it's been a week. And I'm a principal developer at a little company called Stepstone. We only have like 1,500 people in 21 countries. We don't even have a business in Poland, so you never heard of us. But we're in eight European countries. We have like 60 million views every month. We do job boards. So we do portals with job offers for people. And yes, we're hiring, so we have a booth. Just if you go on the other side of this wall, it's right behind the screen. There's some very nice people there to talk to. We have a nice game, so come visit us. Good. So, the agenda for this half an hour talk, very briefly. Some of you may not be very familiar with Docker, so I'm just going to spend 2 minutes covering some basics, and then we're going to go straight to the Dockerized toolbox. So you have really large tools and tools, putting them in Docker containers, explaining why you would do this in the first place, and finishing with some caveats, things, problems you might encounter as you mentioned. Docker. If you don't know Docker, you can imagine this is very lightweight virtualization, not very, but lightweight virtualization, simply. And lightweight compared to what? Compared to traditional virtualization, where you have layers, you have the host operating system at the very bottom, then you have a hypervisor, and the VMware, and the virtual box, and the wireless series. And on top of that, you have those virtual machines. And each virtual machine has to have its own guest operating system. This is the heavy part. This can go into gigabytes of space and it takes time to load up. So virtual machine, if you restart it, it takes a couple of seconds, a couple of minutes, depending on the size. And on top of that, you would have your runtime, your libraries, and your applications. This is just traditional virtualization. Docker, on the other hand, you may notice the hypervisor is gone. Docker, I think. So Docker is much more lightweight. If guest OS is gone, the containers are still there, the isolation is still there of the environment, processes, and networking. So you get all the benefits of isolation and portability, but much more lightweight. Those containers start up instantly. And you can run them just like virtual machines in any environment. I'm a Windows guy, so I apologize for that as well. But you can run them on Windows. You can run them on your Macs, you can run them on Amazon, most of the clouds these days, and so, one more thing about Docker stuff, the terms. I'm gonna be totally mixing those. But when I talk about images, this is a read-only template of the container when it comes. So it has the runtime, it has the libraries, it has the application to run it, but it's not running, it's read-only. When I say container, it's actually a template that's running with a write layer on the file system. So you can actually do things. Like I said, I'm gonna be mixing those. I'm going to try to be consistent in my talk. That's all about Docker. So, we don't have those containers, and we can put stuff in containers. We can run arbitrary things, process in the containers. So why not take that, and why not run our tools? All the phpUnit, Composer, phpmd, phplog, and what else you use for developers. At least those that are in the pipeline. First question answer is why would you do this, but I will put this afterwards, later. Let's first see how this looks in practice. So, this is a Docker file. You may or may not be familiar with the format, so I'm just going to quickly explain. First, it's like an extends clause. I'm using the base official container for PHP like 7.0, CLI, and like interface, which means I already have PHP in the command line. I can use with all the necessary libraries and some basic extensions and stuff. Then I'm putting a run command, and this command is run only at when I build the image. It's not running when the container is running, it's only once I run curl. I download actually the var file from phplog, lines of code. If you don't know the tool, use some statistics about the source code. I output this, make this executable, obviously, and I put this somewhere in the path so that I can just run it with phplog. But the first thing, then I also define the volume and make it a working directory for the container. So that when the container is finalize any actual code. Finally, there's the entry point. And the entry point is simply the process that will be run when the first when the container starts. I can pass parameters to it from the outside, and this is what will be run, basically. Now, let's build this, actually.
Somebody, and that's the case with the composer, for instance. So for
this Docker file I was quite lazy. I just chose the ready piece of code that I can use to compose it on. The downside of it is, first, that they may or may not be maintained. You will notice that PHP doesn't have any prefix here, it doesn't have any slash, which means it's an official image, and it's actually supported by the Docker organization as well. This one is just some guy who created the composer, repository on Docker app, and he's actually one point who even pushed to it. That's the first item. And the second caveat in this case is actually that you're running somebody else's code on your machine, your local machine. It's in a container, but then, you know, it's a fairly young technology, and technology security may not always be there. So you may want to at least inspect the Docker files that you're making this using your official images. After this one, I just use it's empty. I'm quite happy with the default setup of Composer. I just wanted to have it in my own namespace, and I wanted to script it all in one go. If I have a composer in a container and I can paste from it, I can actually use this one also to install some of those tools, which I create for PHP metrics. This is easier, I just run composer, go back to PHP metrics, change the default entry point, which default was in the composer, and PHP metrics works all the same way. Then you would run them all the same way, and you would script them all the same way, obviously. Or you can, how you attach the containers, you can put them in faster. So far from the basic idea. Now, why? Why would you do this? Why wouldn't you just install all those tools? We have your apps, you can install those things, and then you can just run out of commands, and you're going to be happy with those. I mean, Windows 10 is less friendly, maybe, so maybe that's one reason. But here's a good one, good reason possible. You can run multiple versions of these tools, or these tools in multiple versions on multiple versions of PHP or whatnot, simultaneously. You can run them own machine this way. You just create different Docker files, one can be based in PHP 5.6, one can be PHP 7. You can have different versions of PHPUnit, maybe one is working with some old code, and there are some deprecations that you don't want to remove, but you still want to test new code and new one. Perfect, fine. Keep those two versions equally available on your own machine, and then later just delete the old image and it's gone. Very easy thing. Reason number two is Express Sandbox setup. New guy comes to work and his laptop or her laptop and it's empty. They have do I need to install now, spend 2 days installing those old tools? No. Not really. I mean here's a repository with Docker files and this is it. You just close the repository, then you just script it in some script, I call this Toolbox SH. And then you just build those images, then you run another command which creates the running script and you're done. Actually, if you're serious about using Docker, you probably have your own Docker registry running inside your company. So just one person needs to do the building, and then the only thing is you give it a name, you give it an image tag, it needs to have the address of the registry, it can be registry like in our case. And then it still creates a script, but the first time you try to run one of the scripts in one of those containers, you can just download them from the regular registry. Upgrading new versions, just remove the containers and let everybody else hold them. Jesus, no. The third use case is what I call the Dockerized build process. I actually stole this from Sandbox, one of their creators a while ago. You may have Jenkins, some continuous integration tool, demon, and you have your build pipeline going somewhere. It probably has stages like git, checking out go, then your composer, then all the dependencies, then your unit test, and whatever. Now, you can just run those, and you can just put those in containers and run those same tools in containers. I don't know how it works exactly in your case, but we're running all those builds on a number of agents, and there are people taking care of those agents, and they always have a backlog that goes on from here until November next year. So if I want a new tool, if I want some, to try out something new, you know, can you please install this for me in the building and something like that? Yeah, maybe next year. No, now we actually only have Docker on the agents, and when I need a new tool, I run the Docker file, I create a Docker file for it, and I run the whole build in containers. And I also have, by the way, guarantee that every single build is very clean, because the container runs from a read-only image, there's nothing in the environment other than I put in the image for that, and then the container dies, and there are no dependencies, there are no crashes in that. Finally, caveats. I mentioned one with running arbitrary code, not the other way. Second one is related to the file size. I told you that tell them that the PHP log image is 360 megabytes or 180 megabytes. There's a lot of actions. In the containers, the images are available on layers. Every single run command creates a new layer. So there will be a run command to install Apache, run command to install PHP, run command to install the PHP extensions, and then something to add the application. That would be at least four layers. The purpose of these layers is that they can be reused between containers. Containers can share the layers if they are identical, and they can if the run commands are identical between them. You can share some of the layers some of the time, it's up to you. But it only works if the order of run commands is identical. So if you want, for instance, to have several container images sharing xdebug, then make sure that this xdebug is in the same place and is preceded by the same commands. Then it will be shared. Otherwise, you will be actually wasting your disk space because all these layers will be different. Second caveat is you will need extensions and libraries depending on what application you're running. I mean, we're talking tools here, but you will be running with different code bases and different applications, which will have different requirements. So you probably want to be on the safe side and install too many dependencies rather than too few. You need different extensions, you just put them in the containers. This isn't production containers, this isn't production images, we'll not run those in production. It's safe most of the time to package them with the extensions and libraries. And if you run the command and complains it doesn't have an extension, just add it to the Docker file,